Yes, so my name is Katrine Gasser, and I am head of section at the IT department at the Royal Danish Library. There was a lot of things that I could tell you about in this presentation, but I'm going to nail it down to looking at the way or the journey of a library lab seen from an IT or the IT department's perspective. So the Royal Danish Library, we have three main functions. We are a university library, we make national services for the public libraries, and we're also a national library. We of course have a lot of collections. I have just taken out the three grand digital collections. We have the Danish Net Archive, which we have harvested since 2005. So it's all DK domains that we harvest up until now. Then we have radio and TV, where we have 2.3 million hours of audio and video. And then we have digitized newspapers, going back from 1666 and until today. So the journey of a library lab, I'm just going to go through the elements that we have run into on our journey. The first thing is that we have had innovation weeks in the IT department. We have had various research projects going on. We have had an ongoing collaboration with researchers and contact to the researchers at the universities during the year. Then in 2006, we have had a discussion about setting up a digital scholarship center. This is where I first met Mahendra, and I have learned a lot from what he has been doing. In 2006, we also put up a website, which we called KB Labs, where we put up the tools that we made in the department. And then what has recently been said in the news is that the government is going to give 63 million Danish crowns to strengthen the Royal Library's collaboration with university and provide better opportunities for making knowledge available to research. So here we have the money, hopefully. Of course, we also have a lot of partnerships with other organizations that we have been involved with during the years. So this has all been elements and things that we have run into during the past years. Now I will go back to the IT department, because Innovation Weeks has played a big part in what we've been doing. So we started having Innovation Weeks in 2006. These weeks are inspired by Google, where developers get 20% of their time off just to innovate. So we have had that since 2006. Today we have it twice a year. And during those weeks, of course, we innovate and we're very creative and we play frisbee, we eat pizza. And on the last picture that you see on the bottom, we end the week with a demonstration where we invite the rest of the library to look at what we have been doing. We also record it so people can go in afterwards and see what kind of projects that has been doing. So yeah, as I said, there's a lot of things that I could point out, but what I want to tell you about now is the journey of the Smurf tool, because I think that's a pretty little story. So this story starts with me and two colleagues going over to the university to a conference about digital humanities. We met some researchers and they were totally excited about this NBRAM. And we went back, and we had an innovation week and we were like, okay, let's just do it on the newspaper collection. So we did, and we ended up having a tool. But it didn't end there, because we had to get it out, which is the next level. So after having made the first thing there, it was my job to run down to a lawyer. I had to run up and down a lot in the next couple of months to get this thing online. But finally we managed to get it out. So it's online, you can use it all over. The next step on the journey of Smurf was that we had another innovation week. And one of my other colleagues, he was like, okay, I'll just combine this with some geodata. So So he plotted it in something that we call dots, where you can see the occurrences of the words in the newspapers on a map. But it didn't stop there. So now we had some tools out for the new newspapers. Then we had another innovation week, and the next developer came, and he was like, he heard a lot of things, you know, about the net archive, and you know, we can't, everything is sensitive, and you know, we can't show anything to anybody except from researchers. So he was like, hey, but HTML tags, I mean, there's nothing sensitive about that. So let me just plot that into to this Smurf tool. So he did, and we finally got the tags tool. And then me again, up and down with the lawyer, can we do this? This is not sensitive. And finally, in the end, we managed to get this online. And why this is interesting is because this is actually the first hole that we got into the Net Archive. I'm not sure if it's used, but we made a hole, the first one. So this is how things can develop working in an IT department. Unfortunately, I don't have time to run through the next tools, but I will send you a link to these afterwards. PixPlot is now out. It was out yesterday, so you can go and check how these tools. Yeah, great projects with a great impact that we have had. We have run a data management project. It was 2 years. It was a funded project. And the outcome of it was that we set up open access repository for researchers to deposit their research data. Unfortunately, right now it's only open data that we can put in, but my wish and hope is that we can make one for sensitive data too. Then I will briefly mention the cultural heritage cluster project, which we also have. That's also a funded project. We have, in short, set up a supercomputer in the department. We are running pilot projects on it together with researchers today. My colleague Pierre will tell you more about it, so I will just jump to the next. So what have we learned so far? Well, we have learned that it's very important to network. And why? This is because this is where we get the good ideas. As I told you, the Smurf idea just came from networking. Collaboration, why is that important? Well, then I wrote, the lab tango takes more than two people. It takes the researcher, it takes the collection manager, it takes a lawyer. We haven't talked much about that, but maybe that's the elephant in the room. We need to have the girl with the technical skills, or boy. And then, of course, we need to have the university librarians who should push this out and make researchers aware of the things that we're doing. Then I ask myself, from the library's perspective, why are we doing this? This is because we know everything about our collections and almost everything. And we have the technical skills in-house to work with our collections. So I think that's an important role that the library has to fulfill. Then, as I said, as I started with, this was just the IT perspective that you just came through, but there's a lot of other things going on. You can see there's a lot of people from the Royal Danish Library. So there are more things going on. Right now, the management is working on a strategic level on how to work with e-science. We have an application out. I'm writing it together with Hazel for setting up a network for research libraries regarding digital humanities. Then we have three physical labs in Copenhagen already. They have a whole story themselves. but the nice thing is that now that that we're working more together, Aarhus University is actually also planning on setting up a lab at their library in Aarhus. And of course they are talking to the guys in Copenhagen. So, and then I just saw the other day that another step for is that the health faculty in Aarhus have just posted a job ad for where they look for a digital scientist. So the field is moving. Then, getting the right people together. So what also, one of the nice things that came out of all these things that we've been doing is that we now have a trainee, Max. He's a historian on his final year. And because, you know, we talk with people, we decided to have him as a trainee in our department. So I placed him just next to all the developers. So he's sitting there having a good time here. One of our hardcore developers, Mr. Knows Everything, I said it, is teaching him how to use a printer. But I am sure that you will see Max in a couple of years to all of these conferences because he's really clever. We're teaching him how to program, we're teaching him everything. So that's our future. That was it. Thank you.
Oh. 5 minutes for questions.
Tell us about the presentation at the end of the Innovation Weeks where you invite the whole library. That sounds quite big.
Yeah, so we broadcast it so they can also, and we record it so they can also go in and see it afterwards. Yeah.
What's the general tone of this meeting? Is it generating much interest in the?
Well, some of the things that we do are very technical, so we split it up. So the first part is very, very technical, and the other things are the second part is we try to plan it so it's aimed for the rest of the library.
Can I congratulate you on inventing a new word, labs tango? I've never Welcome. Seen those two things together. That's very cool.
Yeah.
Questions?
Can I just ask another question about the Innovation Week?
So yes.
Maybe it's two parts. So sounds very expensive.
Yes.
So I wonder how many people are taking part in it, right? And what the, just a bit of process is for deciding what people work on during it.
Oh, that's a lot of different things. One of the things that I highlighted, which I didn't tell you about, was the search that we did, which is used, was something that was developed in an Innovation Week. And as I told, it was given as a Christmas present for the rest of the library. They implemented it, and now it's the search system for the entire library. So it has value, some of the things, yeah.
Just a different question. how many people are involved in it?
So it's the IT department. It's 30 developers. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And how do you pick the things that you work on?
Well, people decide themselves what they want to do. Mm-hmm. It has to be related to the library, so it's not just like I'm going to I'm going hunting, but it should have relevance. But if someone wants to, I don't know, read a book about, I don't know, some new programming language, then he does it in that week. Or develops a tool.
Sorry, I think we're all really interested in these innovation weeks. How do you do this in your department in the usual setup? I'm just like wondering what kind of how you modify the space or the situation so people get into a different mindset and don't go like as business and do business as usual.
Well, we have done. Well, you get time off, and actually, we tell people to block their calendar.
Okay.
So, and I'm sure that Mons, he can. The calendar is blocked. So, if you come outside from another department and you want, and if you want a meeting, I mean, we really mean it. I mean, yeah. Yeah.
Okay. So nobody can bother you with anything.
No.
And do you any physical modifications to the room, or do you go?
No. Room, we let people do what they want, and they're good at it. doing things on their own.
Time for maybe one more question.
just a remark. When we joined together Copenhagen and others, the Copenhagen branch didn't do it, this innovation thing in exactly the same way. And now we sort of putting it together, mostly actually using the Aarhus way of doing it. And the good thing there is that we sort of start with a few days in advance sort of preparing for it. So if we want to get hold of a data set or do something in advance, we can prepare and we have it all, in place when starting the actually working. And then there is one or two days after, I don't remember how many.
Two Fridays before and two after.
We can prepare a presentation or put it online as a demo or something. And this way of preparation and reporting and work in between, I think that's one of the things that have made this so good as we feel it as developers.